Okay, we're gonna get started because it's 10 o'clock and our lesson's become cool. So, and I can honor the time that you guys are taking out for this event. So, first of all, thank you so much for coming to the speaker series session. We have a wonderful guest speaker for us to do the speaking test. She's one of my mentors from when I was in grad school. She was one of my mentors for the Hawaiian Learning Program. For those who don't know, it's Paragraph School of Social Work here at UH Manoa. Basically, what we do in the Hawaiian Learning Program is we translate Western practices and policies into something that is more closely relevant for our Hawaiian population and communities. So, this is one of the topics that we did cover extensively in our Hawaiian Learning Program, and I felt that this is something that is very applicable to the various fields that you will all be going into, whether it's education, whether it's health, whether it's teaching, sciences. It's very applicable because of the outreach and the communities that you all eventually be working with. Welcome to the families of our scholars who are here. I hope you will be able to learn from this as well. If you haven't yet, please sign in at the back. There are evaluations that need to be done after the event. They will be emailed to you. Okay, so that's why I asked for the email. There has to be one done for everyone that's in attendance. So if you did bring family members, please make sure that they do it as well. There are hard copies for the guests and Ohana members. They can do the hard copy. You can input it on the survey link yourself if you want to, or you can scan a copy to me and I can put it in. It doesn't matter. I just need to make sure it gets done. Okay? So without further ado, anything moving on? Okay.
Okay. Education,
social work.
Social work.
Yay,
social work. I'm a social worker.
Public health.
Public health. Okay. What else?
How many of you that are in the helping profession or will be, want to be in the helping profession? So it's going to be really important for you all to understand the impact, yeah, of cultural historical trauma. Okay. How many of you are in Hawaiian studies, have taken Hawaiian studies classes? How many of you are native speakers or are working towards being a native speaker? Okay. Those of you who didn't say, haven't said anything. Interest. Help me learn something about you. The other thing I'm going to ask of you is that you speak up. Okay, because I'm kupuna and I can't hear that well. So I'm always going to ask you to speak quietly. Could you repeat that? Okay. What I want to do is start with an exercise. So I would like this half of the room. Can you take out a piece of paper, kind of like that, plain piece of paper, any kind of paper that you can really tear up and okay, fold it in half.
Here.
We're going to tear it up. So hold it in half. Just half of you. This is when we're going to be ecologically responsible. This half, fold it in half, tear it, and share it with that half. Okay? There you go. Share a piece of paper with the other side of the room, please. And then, you know that half a piece of paper you got? Fold it in three and tear that. So you're gonna need three pieces of paper. I'm not going to collect them, so you can write anything you want. Okay. people, places, values, beliefs, three things that are so important to you today that if you didn't have them, your life would look remarkably different. Three really critical things in your life that you value. Some of you, really easy, yeah.
Right.
Three things. Wow. Who's not done? So, what I like to hear from you is just one of them, the most important that you wrote down. Remember, you got to talk loud. So plenty, yeah. Okay. What else? Anything else? Anybody put something different?
God.
Turn those pieces of paper over. I'm going to ask Amanda to help me. Okay? Over. And this side of the room, pick one of them. Pick one of them. Pick one of them. Crumple it up. Okay, turn over your other between that you have. Turn it over. What's missing? What did you take?
Faith.
Huh?
Faith.
Faith.
You took Ohana.
Oh, okay.
Faith.
For how many of you did you take your Ohana?
You would take mine.
Oh, you only took one Ohana? Ohana?
You would have taken mine.
Okay, so for some of you, what's missing? What did you take?
Culture.
What did you take?
Knowledge.
Well, you know what? You're gone from the university. Yeah? You're gone. You took your knowledge. You're gone from the university. You need to go back. Where you came. Your culture? Don't know what to say about that. So you're learning.
more Western ways, yeah, and you have to give up your Hawaiian being, all right? Yes.
Kuleana.
Responsibility. So you're just an irresponsible burden on the rest of society. Because you ain't got no kuleana anymore. Okay, that's what you feel. And your faith?
Yeah.
So at this point, you have lost your sense of spirituality. You no longer have that sense of spirituality that you have defined as important to you. What did you lose?
Ohana.
You lost your ohana. Your family is gone, and those people that you wrote down on that paper, you will probably never see again. Yes.
Stable?
Yes. Okay. So you're wandering around unstable, not knowing who you are, what you're going to be, what your role is in society. Okay? What else? Front, around here. What did you lose?
Your initiative.
Almost like no kuleana also. So you're kind of a burden on society because you don't have a job. No initiative, no motivation. Yeah? What did you lose?
Kindness.
You're one of these people who go around stealing from others. You don't work. You don't need to because you just take from others. You're a little burden on society. What else? What else did you lose? Okay. So what happens is you lose one thing that's precious. And guess what? There's going to be a replacement. So you've lost something really important to you, and here's what it gets replaced with. Here's what it gets replaced with.
Hello.
Here's what it gets replaced diabetes. So you know something about this. Your parent, one of your parents is incarcerated. What else did you pick?
Sex abuse.
Lost child? Like to CPS? That kind of lost child? Okay, your kids get taken away. You're not a good parent, or somebody said you're not a good parent. What did you get?
Loss of significant role model to suicide.
Loss of a significant role model to suicide. What else?
Sexual abuse.
Huh?
Sex abuse.
Substance abuse?
Sex abuse.
Okay, so in your family, there was sex abuse. Anybody get substance abuse? Nobody picked substance abuse? You got substance abuse in your family. What else?
Poverty.
Anybody else get poverty? Okay. I want you to go inside yourself, and I want you to experience A, what was it like for you to lose one of the most cherished things in your life and then have it replaced with something else that had a lot of negative connotations? So I want you to go inside of yourself and experience it. Experience it as a feeling, okay? Inside yourself. And when you're ready, I'd like you to share that. Losing something precious and having it replaced with something hurtful. Rage. What else? Devastation. And the devastation is caused
because part of me is missing.
You lost your culture and you got what?
I did not grow up with my grandmother.
Okay. She lost her culture and she didn't grow up with her birth father. Part of herself was missing. Sorry. Yes.
Like an extreme depression.
Extreme depression. What did you lose and what did you get instead?
I lost my foundations with my spirituality, and then with my mom became incarcerated, I just lost all ties to any kind of solidity in my life.
So she lost her spiritual foundation, and one of her parents was incarcerated. What else?
Helplessness?
Say that again?
Helplessness.
Helplessness. Something has happened outside of your control. Something was taken away. And in its place, you got something kind of devastating. And you don't have any control over that. Talk about feeling unstable. Yeah? What else? What else? Yes.
Went from losing my family, being a people person, to becoming recluse.
Reclusive. Part of the reclusiveness is feeling helpless, maybe, and hopeless because you lost your ohana. And what did you get in its place?
Emptiness.
What did we?
Oh, gangs and criminality.
Gangs? Gangs. So any family that he had left were in gangs. What else? I'm going to ask this question.
for how many of you, you're scared that if you say something right now, you would start to cry? You don't want to cry. If I open my mouth and say how I'm feeling, I start to cry. I'm ashamed, cry. I don't want to cry. So I'm not going to say anything. So let me see, show of hands again, those of you who have never heard the term cultural historical trauma. Let me see your hands again. You know what you all are experiencing in this room?
Cultural historical
trauma. Cultural historical trauma is the effect of psychological, economical, and social effects of colonization. What's colonization? What's colonization? A dominant culture or society coming in and subjecting another culture to its ways. Yeah? We as a Hawaiian people were colonized. Indigenous people across the world have been colonized by dominant cultures. In Australia, it was what? The British. And it was the Aboriginal indigenous people who were colonized. And I don't know if you know this, but the British people looked around at Aboriginal people, and they said, we need to make them like British subjects, and this is how we're going to do it. We're going to take all part Aboriginal kids, and we're going to send them off to boarding schools. So they came, and they took the kids away from their families involuntarily, took them to boarding schools hundreds of miles away, and raised them to be British citizens. In the United States, the same thing happened with Native Americans, right? Native American families were forced to send their kids to boarding schools where their hair was cut. They were not allowed to speak their native language. And all that was Indian was beat out of them. And what happened here in Hawaii? What happened here in Hawaii?
They couldn't speak Hawaiian, from what I've heard, in public. And at home, I guess some parents could speak Hawaiian, but the children were already picking up English language when they were not understanding what their parents were talking about. Now it's a lost culture where I guess for like my age, I haven't really learned Hawaiian enough.
So there is a law passed that said that only English was to be spoken in the schools. So what happens is that sometimes people will argue with us and they said, oh no, no, no. It wasn't true that there was a law that said that you couldn't speak Hawaiian. And technically they're right, because it was a policy of the Department of Education where only English was taught in the school. And think back to our grandparents, right? Already they were feeling the effects of colonization. Yeah, the effects of one culture dominating their culture, our culture. And I know my grandma said to her kids, you know, if this is the way it's going to be, in order for you all to succeed, you have to learn English. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to learn English. So you go to school and you learn English. And so while Hawaiian was spoken in the home, my family at least supported the kids learning English. Now, I think our grandparents had no idea the effects of what happens when a culture
culture loses its language, right? Mm-hmm. You lose your language, you lose your culture. Right? You mm-hmm. lose your language, you lose your culture. Because embedded in our language are the world views of that culture.
Mm-hmm.
So in Hawaiian thinking, how many of you speak Hawaiian again? In Hawaiian language, there's so many words for we. Yeah? It's you and me, just us two. It's more than us two. It's you and me, but not her. Right? It's all of us, but not him. Because why? Because in a small island culture, it's so important to know these things about who's in and who's out without hurting people's feelings, right? So we can talk about Mako. I can talk to him about Mako, and it's all us. And he knows he ain't included, right? He has some decisions about that, but right up front, he knows that when I talk about Mako, he's not included. Whereas, right, in Western thinking, and I talk about us, he goes, what does that mean? Does that include me? Can I go too? He doesn't know. Right? So embedded in the language is how we view each other. How we view our relationship with a higher power. How we view our relationship with Ohana. So we lose our language, we lose our culture. We lose our sense of spirituality, we lose our culture. So what? Western people came in and they said, what? You talk to trees and the wind? The rocks talk to you? You gotta be crazy.
Mm-hmm.
No, we have one God. And this is how you're gonna worship one God. Right? Or they make fun of us for worshiping the wind and the rain and the rocks and the pool and the owls. Right? So what happens? We stay shamed. Right? We become a shame-based culture. We shame being Hawaiian. And when we're shamed, we feel helpless, yeah? We feel lost.
You get mad.
We don't have kuleana anymore because there's nothing to be kuleana about. It's cultural, historical trauma. Okay? That's cultural, historical trauma. So even though this quote was from an Aboriginal elder, listen to how it kind of sounds like us. Yeah? Our dignity was taken away. And a lot of people don't realize that. They don't really understand about how our dignity was taken away from us. How we were taught to be ashamed of being Native. Then our self-respect was gone. Once you lose your self-respect, how can you respect someone else? That's real critical. I lose my self-respect. How can I respect someone else? Then you take your frustrations out on other people. So it wasn't too long ago. No, Hawaiians were ashamed of being Hawaiians. And we took out our frustrations on other people. And then we were known as a culture of substance abusing domestic violence people. Yeah. All right, let's go. So you were talking about culture. Yeah? So culture is the glue that holds any group of people together. Any group of people. It's the way we operate. It's the way we say I'm of value. It's the way that we value others. Okay? And I use a really simple definition of culture. Culture, if you think think about it, and it's not just Hawaiian culture, it could be different kinds of culture. It's the way we meet and greet. How we say hello, how we say goodbye is cultural. What we eat and how we eat it is cultural. How we solve problems is cultural. Yeah. Very simple. It's how we do things together as a group of people. That's culture. And if you lose your culture, you don't know how to act. Yeah. Okay. So you have the PowerPoint, and I don't need to go over what culture is. So cultural historical trauma was a term coined by a Lakota Indian social worker. Her name was Malina Yellow Horse Braveheart. She was a Lakota Indian, and if you know anything about the Lakota Indian history, this was the tribe where 300 of 400 people were killed in what was known as the Battle at Wounded Knee. How many of you have heard of that? Wounded Knee? Okay. It was originally called the Battle of Wounded Knee, but when one of the historians read the account, he renamed it the Massacre at Wounded Knee because the tribe was basically unarmed, and the 7th Cavalry came in and basically opened fire on them. So because 300 of the 400 group were killed, it was a huge traumatic event for the tribe, and it took them a long, long time to come to terms with that. Okay. She also looked at the term and used information on the Holocaust, the Japanese, the internment of Japanese after World War I, and a series of groups of people who were colonized or subjugated. She looked at slavery. Yeah. So how many of you have Japanese heritage in your background? How many of you have Native American heritage in your background? How many of you have African American heritage in your background? Besides one. Okay. All of that she looked at and came up with the term cultural historical trauma. Okay. All right. So here's the academic definition, okay? It's the cumulative emotional and psychological wounding across generations, including in one's own lifespan. And it's, as I said, the aftermath of colonialism and post-colonialism to which indigenous people have been subjected. And the trauma is held personally within ourselves and transmitted over generations. So even family members who have not directly experienced the trauma can feel the effects of the trauma. So for example, when you look at the massacre at Wounded Knee, it happened in the mid-1800s. How come 7 generations later, the effects of the trauma are still evident in the kids? Why do you think that's so? What do you think that's so? That's the next one? Oops, okay, let's back it up. I don't know where it went. Okay. Okay, why do you think that's so? Let's look at this. Here's the take-home message of cultural historical trauma. It's intergenerational. It gets passed down. The pain, the eha, gets passed down from generation to generation. Can you think about your family members mom and dad, okay, who have experienced the rage, the devastation, the depression, the no cause for living, the helplessness, and the reclusiveness. Because they have directly experienced overthrow of the monarchy, cannot speak Hawaiian, taking away a sense of spirituality. And it becomes just the way they are. They're mad, but they don't, okay? And their kids don't get a kind of parenting because mom and dad are so depressed, okay? Mom and dad are so depressed. Dad has taken to drinking too much. Then he's so upset he's beating up his wife, and the kids see that. No ability, no resiliency. Yeah, that's the word we use, resiliency. Limited resilience. So the kids, guess what? The kids get this passed down to them. And they don't understand why. Because that's how life in their ohana has always been. So it's not like me, as the ohana say, you know what? My leg hurts, I'm going to the doctor says, oh, you have a cyst. Oh, okay, I can fix that, right? It's something that is so pervasive in our lives, we don't even know what to call it. We just know there's something empty in our na'au, but that's the way it's always been. Life is like that. Mom beats up, dad beats up mom, mom yells at us. These kids pass it down to their kids. Yep. Pretty soon nobody knows why the eha is there. We don't even know it's eha. We pass it down and pass it down. And until it gets interrupted, it gets passed down. Anybody want to comment on that? Yes.
I think there's been a nurtured environment. What you see around you, you feel that's the way it's supposed to live. And you become a product of the environment itself.
So are you saying that there's a positive element to that?
No. I guess they just don't have that drive to want to get out of it and remain in it.
And I just want to be clear that this doesn't happen to all of us collectively, everybody, okay? But there are segments of our culture where that's still prominent, or it has been prominent. Okay? The fact that you're all here sitting in this chair today says that something happened in your ohana where education was valued, or something happened in you where you said education was valued, or somebody said to you, hey, you're kind of smart. You gotta go to college. Yeah? Something happened in your lives to get you today, sitting here. So I'm speaking generally about the concept of cultural historical trauma. What I'd like you to do is to kind of sit with it. How has it been a factor in your ohana and or your community? Or what was it about your ohana and your community? Whether your community is a geographical community, your church community, your athletic community, somehow. What was it about your ohana? Hana and your community, where you were afforded, yeah, you were afforded a positive upbringing, and somehow your ohana overcame that intergenerational trauma. Because you know what happens with intergenerational trauma? Oftentimes communities and ohana develop a subculture. How many of you saw Once Were Warriors? Okay, that movie is about a subculture, the gang culture in Aotearoa, in New Zealand, right? The subculture of violence. And what happens is, because we're so frustrated, yeah, we take out our frustrations on other people, and that Once Were Warrior film was really about that consequence of being colonized and that subculture of violence. And what happens when we as a group, say a Hawaiian, develop a subculture of aggression and violence? And we have it, don't we? In our culture, we have high prevalence of substance use. We have high prevalence of domestic violence. Same thing is true with Native Americans. High prevalence of alcoholism, substance abuse, high prevalence of domestic violence. So the outside world looks at us, and what do they say? Oh, look at them Hawaiians. Look at them Hawaiians. Violent, beat up on each other, lazy. How many of you grew up Hawaiians being dumb, lazy, good for nothing? Yeah. Partly because of this. Yeah. So, okay, let's try it again. So this is what happens with, yes?
I think that also people in that culture being to look at themselves that way too. Everybody looking at us saying we're lazy and stuff, and then that affects the way we identify with ourselves and what we do.
Absolutely. I'm going to talk about it because that's the second take-home message. The first take-home message is that it's intergenerational. We're going to get to the second take-home message. But here's what happens as individuals, okay? And I bet you know people who have these characteristics. Now we feel, okay, inclusive, we feel alienated and isolated. We feel shame. Shame, that word came up every day of my life growing up. Yeah, shame, yeah? Oh, shame. And you can do all kinds of things. Yeah? We're ashamed, we've become a shame-based culture, and we're getting out of it. We're getting out of it, because you all are sitting here. We're getting out of it. But at one time, we really talked about being shamed. We're angry, rage. We don't like ourselves. And we're going to talk about internalized oppression. How when a group of people get colonized and oppressed, how we turn that oppression inside ourselves. And it's called internalized oppression. We'll get to that. We have low self-esteem, we fear authority, we then act in self-destructive, aggressive ways that we've talked about, and we're ambivalent. We're not sure we want to be Hawaiian. Anybody remember or know people who didn't want to acknowledge that they were Hawaiian? Shame being Hawaiian. Yep. What's interesting is that there are studies that say that high cultural identification is a resilient factor that leads one to be more resilient. So if we identify with our culture, in general, we demonstrate higher resiliency. At one time in our history, that was not true. That an identification with being Hawaiian resulted in low self-esteem. Sad, yeah. Really sad. Really sad. Okay. So what is the impact of historical trauma on families? As we talked about, in intergenerational. It's unresolved grief. The reality is that we have been grieving for generations. The reality is those survivors of the massacre at Wounded Knee have been grieving for generations. They didn't even know that they were grieving. Okay? Those African American communities were grieving the consequences of slavery and the fracturing of families. Grieving. The survivors of the Holocaust, grieving. Okay? And their unresolved grief. When we have unresolved grief, we take it out on other people, mainly our ohana. High prevalence of family violence. We know it from our history. We know it from our history. And when we're so engrossed in the grieving and the eha, we lose our memo. We lose our stories. It's the stories and traditions, yeah, that keep our families alive. It's the stories of grandpa and great-grandpa that keep our families vibrant. The stories, the mo'olelo. We live by our mo'olelo. But with cultural historical trauma, the mo'olelo is gone. So you all are writing, are helping to write your family, your ohana mo'olelo. And of course, loss of identity, as we talked about. And so communities, there's a loss of traditions. There's a loss of connections to our language. Yeah, we almost lost our language, right? It wasn't until the 1970s that groups of people said, whoa, if we don't do something now, not if our language is gone, our culture is gone. So we, you all, are so lucky, yeah, to have your language, your ohana back. We're still fighting about control over our land and our water. So you might want to say that the cultural historical trauma is still going on today. Mm-hmm. They're still bombing Makua. Right? We finally got Kaho'olawe back, but cracked water table, you can't grow anything there. Our kupuna in Waianae, when the fires hit, they have respiratory problems. Some of them make, some of them die. The trauma is still happening today. Okay? But we're fighting for them. Yeah? And then, of course, that violence is often community-based. And the fixation on the trauma. Let me tell you a story of what it means by fixating on the trauma. I have permission to tell this story because I'm going to talk about Waianae. Okay? I have a friend who is from Waianae, very connected with Waianae. She was accepted to JABSUM Medical School. She tells this story. She said, I went home, I told my ohana, I got in medical school. She said, you know what my auntie said to me? She said, so what? You think you're better than the rest of us? Think you're better than the rest of us. You're going to go Honolulu, you're going to be a doctor, you're going to make money. Why do you want to do that? My friend said, oh my God, I was shocked. I thought everybody would say, oh, fabulous. You got in medical school, you're going to be a doctor. She said, no, half my family. I said, look, better than the rest of us. That's an example of a fixation on the trauma. Can you see that?
Fixation on the trauma.
That's an example of a fixation. It's like, here we are. We're all stuck here. Why do you want to go? Why do you want to leave us? Okay?
You just said thought about when we were growing up, crabs in a bucket.
The crabs in the bucket. How many of you don't know the crabs in the bucket story? Okay, Uncle, tell them the crabs in the bucket story.
Every time one tries to get up, the others are pulling them down.
It's a story that I grew up with. Gotta stay in the bucket of crabs.
or what? Wouldn't be better than you. Yeah? So now, right, you're in a position. People, I bet, say to you, you're in university. Great. Keep going, Brock. Yeah? You get encouraged now. Not at one time. That's fixation. And what I want you to know is that it's characteristic of people who feel the effects of cultural historical trauma. It's really not something bad about the individual. It's characteristic. It happens all over the world. Okay? So we know now that the encouragement to go back to school. So you know what? In Massachusetts, moms and dads and the grandmas and grandpas, they say, oh, how wonderful, you're going to go to college, you're going to go to graduate school, you're going to make money and be proud of us. What did the Hawaiian ohana tell you? Oh, we're so proud of you. You're going to the university. Get your degree, come back to community, and give back. Isn't that what we say to you?
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily, but good. You can make good money. You can provide for your family. It's broader. It's community. Hawaiian families say, get a degree, come home, give back. It's that kokua, kokua mai, yeah, the reciprocity. Very important Hawaiian value. So you all here are going to have the pull of your ohana and community. Come home, give back. Yeah. So I'm looking at all of you. Oh, give back to the community. Make their community stronger. So I'm so glad that you're sitting here. Okay, here's the take-home message. Okay? So the take-home message is oftentimes that is basically it's intergenerational. Okay? It's intergenerational, and oftentimes that you have what's developed is that subculture and think once we're warriors. Okay? All right, and here's something that you were talking about. You know, cultural historical trauma is basically the oppression, you know, of one group or one culture on another. Okay? So oppression is a systematic and institutionalized mistreatment of one group of people by another group of people based on historical and current structures in society. These people who are oppressed are excluded from resources, benefits, or opportunities in society. Does that sound like us?
Yep.
A couple generations ago? Yeah. So the basis of oppression is maintaining the power of those here, right? And control. So here we are, and here's the colonizers, the dominant culture, maintaining the power and control, and basically managing resources. It's like the quota system for education. I went to a private school. I went to a private school. That school had a 10%, the quota was 10% Polynesians and Asians. 10%. That policy was repealed after I graduated. But private school and only 10% of us. All right. So here's the path to oppression. First, there's stereotypes. All Hawaiians are like this. Okay? Hawaiians like this. Indians like this. Aborigines like this. So then, based on stereotypes, and you know, stereotypes are beliefs where there's some basis for truth, perhaps.
some basis for truth that just gets escalated. So then there are beliefs about that particular group, which we all know is prejudice. And then there's action, behaviors, discrimination. And then there's oppression, because if I have a belief about you, okay, whether true or not, I have a belief about you, I have some negative feelings about you, I'm going to discriminate about you. Kind of lazy, I don't want you working in my office, in my agency. That leads to oppression, doesn't it? So internalized oppression, which is what you were talking about, okay, is also a critical take-home message. It's the condition in which an oppressed individual or group comes to believe that they are, in fact, inferior to those in power. Which is why Grandpa used to always say, shame being Hawaiian. No good being Hawaiian. Yeah? So externalized oppression, somebody else doing it, becomes internal when we come to believe and act as if the oppressor's belief, systems, and values and the way of life is preferred. Better be howdy than Hawaiian.
How many of you have heard that growing up or heard that from parents, grandparents? Better be healthy than Hawaii.
And what it means is that the oppressor doesn't have to exert any control over us anymore, because guess what? We do it to ourselves. And it's the crab in the bucket analogy. We do it to ourselves. That's internalized oppression. Nobody has to do it to us anymore because we feel like we're not as good as. Not as good as. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody have examples in the community? Ohana? Yeah.
I know in my siblings and all, we don't have the language because we were trained by school and not to think Hawaiian.
You know why you don't have a Hawaiian name? I don't have a Hawaiian, I mean, I have a Hawaiian name. My first name is Carol. In 1861, something, the 1860s, there was a state law that was passed that everyone born, every child born in wedlock in Hawaii had to have Christian names. That's why our generation have English names. It wasn't repealed till 100 years later, which is why ehu-haired, blue-eyed Hawaiians have really long Hawaiian names now, because they can. But think about it. Think about what it was like to be part Hawaiian and to be in school where 100% of your classmates, brown, yellow, red, had English names. Every single classmate of mine had English names. Now, if that weren't a fabulous acculturation issue, we think, right? English. Now my grandkids and my daughter has a Hawaiian first name, they go, e napua, e kiloki. That matters. That matters. E toshi. That matters.
Because it shows a sense of connection to your culture. Because that shows a sense of connection to your culture and who you are.
Language. language, that sense of connection. Mm-hmm. Toshi, you don't look Japanese. I never knew you was Japanese. So Toshi can tell this story about being Japanese, Irish, or something. Yeah? Eho Olelia, what does that mean? Oh, Olelia can tell the story about how she was named after an ancestor in 1799. I told her the story of how she was named after her ancestor in 1799. But Paul, okay, what story, Paul? Montague, Tyrone, not one, not two, not one, yeah, only a few, not one. What does that mean? Boy, we got acculturated fast. Mm-hmm. That's why you know more Hawaiian than 14. Yeah, not your fault. Your family was abiding by the laws of the time.
I just have a quick story to share. I come from that same culture and generation. When it comes to yours. So I have a brother. He's older.
Speak up so they can hear across the room.
My brother's older. He was here in Hawaii during his younger years. Born here. Born and raised here. So, we did spend some time in Hawaii. But my brother, he moved to the mainland. He's been in California since he was in his early 20s. And he's now more than 50 years old. So, he comes back and he visits all the time. And this last visit he came, I have the Oha newspaper. And it was sitting on my table and he read it. And there was an article about you know, with the whole rail and the EV that they're finding in the hulks, the progress of what they're doing. And my brother made a comment and he said, so what the heck are these Hawaiians complaining about? They don't have anything better to do? This is progress. They get in the way of progress. And, you know, I didn't say anything to him. He doesn't understand. He's so removed from it. And he was brought up, he doesn't understand the culture, so you know, and that's just a good example, because in our family it was like that. You know, some things were missing, the culture was missing, we didn't grow up with that. And so he did it, and he doesn't understand it, you know. And it's sad.
It's sad, but it's not his fault either.
It's not, but so it's so enlightening. Now I understand is what you're saying. Know
why it's that way. I really
couldn't understand, but you know,
I'm inviting to it.
It's making me realize why it's
not. It's not your fault. It's not our fault. What is our kuleana? Yeah? Is to, once we understand it, to make some decisions about how we're going to move forward. And let's talk about how we move forward. Aspects of you. Okay. So we want to end with hope. Yeah. We don't want to end stuck with cultural historical trauma. But the other thing I want you to understand is that context of historical trauma is not your fault. In the same way that we talk with clients or people who have experienced personal trauma, abuse, neglect, yeah, domestic violence, we say it's not your fault. It's not your fault what happened to you, but it is your responsibility to stand up and move forward. Yeah? And which is why you're all here. You're going to school. It's fabulous. So let's look at aspects of healing. One of the things that's really important is that we need to confront our trauma and embrace our history. In 1992, which to some of you probably seems like history, we were commemorating the 100th year overthrow of our monarchy in 1992. And there's, during that year leading up to it, there's a lot of information about what happened. And one of the things that was just astounding to me was so many people didn't know what happened. They knew we'd been overthrown, I mean, that's pretty common, but they didn't know what happened. And one of the things that happened was that as they learned their history, who said rage? They were enraged by hearing what really happened. So it was kind of interesting because in some parts of our community, we were coming together to commemorate the event, and there were pockets of our people who were so angry because they realized what really happened. Yeah? So we need to embrace our history. We need to understand it. We need to embrace it. Because only in the understanding of it can we release the pain. Okay? And in the releasing of the pain, we can transcend our trauma. We can say to our kids, you're smart, you're going to go to school. Okay? You're smart, you're going to go to school. We may not have the money to pay for it, but there's scholarships. You're smart, you're going to apply. And then you want to give back. Okay? So what does it mean in indigenous communities? What does healing mean to us? So I work with trauma survivors. You know, we talk individually about individual healing. But I'm also Hawaiian. And I know that indigenous healing looks different. Okay? Indigenous healing looks different. For us, there's got to be a spiritual component. Yeah? So indigenous healing is a spiritual process that includes some kind of therapeutic change and cultural renewal. That makes sense, yeah? If our cultural has been squashed, then part of our healing has to be to raise our culture. If some important aspect of our culture has been deemed opala by our colonizers, how do we take what has been opala and restore it for you? No. And if it's intergenerational, it's hard. How do we take what people have said was opala and once again honor it? It's hard. This is not opala. This is core, central to us. It's not even about our culture. It's about an Alaskan Native culture. We tried very hard and successfully to once again honor all of the things that we know are central and core and to our well-being. Okay? So this is called Carved from the Heart.
Are we not allowed to park in that little area up front of the Malina? Will we get in trouble?
If you already got a ticket, don't worry about that.
We already got a ticket?
If you did, then you might as well just
leave it there. Okay, I'll leave it there.
Okay. So this is a film about basically this. Honoring who we are as a culture. Come on.
Yeah.
Thank you.
ye to gate yaw to kai yaw to gaf to neat, shkash neat. Hayan AGS aya.
He died of an overdose of cocaine. I had a pain in my heart that night. I don't know if I can explain it. A hurt, an ache, almost like a cramp. But there was also like an open wound, a cut, a stinging. And when I was laying down, there, no matter what position I turned, trying to ease the pain, it never went away.
It was about a month before my brother passed away. My sister called me and told me she was really worried about my brother, and she gave me this number to call because she really thought that we should talk to him. I didn't even try and talk to him because it was frustrating. He was so different. I put this vest on. I had tucked it into a vest pocket and put the vest on after he had passed away. And I pulled out the number. You know, I wrote down, you know, his name and call him. And I didn't ever get to talk to my brother.
And when he died, I found out that I couldn't take care of the pain by myself. No matter what I did, no matter what I took, the pain was there. Trying everything myself until I got contact with other people. And I really thought how much we really need each other. So I thought of the totem pole. A friend of mine brought this up about a week after my boy died, but at that time I didn't feel like making a totem pole. It was about a year later. And the found was. This started out as a family thing, you know. I told my sister that I made a memorial pole for my boy, and they said, yeah, that's fine. You know, when everybody found out what I was doing, everybody wanted to be involved. So I went to my sister again. I told her I'd like to include Craig in this, because everybody really wants to be involved in this. So she said, okay.
Craig is on Prince of Wales Island in southeast Alaska. It is a community of fishers, loggers, and people whose way of life is tied to the land and sea. About 400 of the 2,000 people are Tlingit, Haida, and Tsimshian. Even though Alaska Natives have lived here for countless generations, the Healing Heart totem pole was the first pole carved and raised in Craig in modern times. The pole became a community project, helping to heal not only the Marsden family, but healing the wounds that are passed from generation to generation in other families.
Stan had kind of gathered people around him. He went and told people, hey, you know, he'd be wandering around and doing his business and doing his errands, and he'd run into somebody, he'd say, I got that tree in my pole, I'm going to be carving the pole. And then people would say, oh, wow, what can I do to help? Dan at the very beginning invited everybody to be involved, and so everybody could come carve, anybody could come to the meetings, everything was open.
I'd like to talk about the totem poles that used to be up years ago. We have all kinds of totem poles. Some are for history making. We have totem poles that tell stories about the clan family. But I've never heard of a healing totem pole, but It's a good idea.
When I first found out that my dad was going to carve a totem pole in memory of my brother, I really hoped in my heart that he was going to go through with it. I also was glad, since we had my brother cremated, there was really no place that I could go where I could feel that represented my brother.
When I started the job, nobody showed up. I was really disappointed. Several times there, I was ready to quit. I wondered why I ever started. After a while, different people started drifting in. People never carved before were coming to carving the pole. After a while, the momentum started picking up. Started picking up real. Everything started to snowball. I started to feel good. I didn't know what it was going to be. And I put the finger in there, and I read the person. And he just is what we used to call the Aunty by the tips. That box he was holding, I didn't know what was going to be there.
The next meeting we came to, Stan had something to say right away. He said, you know, there was this blank spot on the pole. I wasn't sure what I was going to carve there. But now I know what I'm going to carve there. I'm going to carve a basket of roses. And then he said, and so what do you think if at the pole raising we give everybody a rose, and then they can go and take their rose and then they can lay it down the totem pole in honor of somebody?
There are things that are really hush-hush. I don't know if it's just in the Native cultures or Native families, but there's a lot of things that just get swept under the carpet. One thing that was really confusing for me is violence at periods of time my dad could fly off the hook, and you just hope that the anger wasn't towards you. I was pretty young. But I watched the anger and the rage directed towards my mom, my sister, and my brother would comfort me. He used to hold me when I was so scared.
I practiced my rage on the fields of Vietnam and in the villages, and no one said a word about it. I was one of six got blown up down by the riverbank. But they had a clear path for the helicopter, the medevac. And the helicopter came in, and they could only take five, and they made me walk out. You know, I was peppered up and down with shrapnel. I still carry shrapnel on my arm today. And I was real angry. 6 months from Vietnam, I was living in a bar. I'd draw down unemployment once a week, and my dad would come down and last the bar. I'd always be passed out in the back or all messed up. And I was passed out, he'd stuff my unemployment check in my pocket. I told the bartender that you know, I left all his money on him. He says, just make sure he eats today, huh? I know he's going to drink it up anyway. That went on for years. I tried to commit suicide many times just in the household. Well, my son, Willard Jr., was saved my life at 7 years old.
I just ran out the door crying. Just in a pair of briefs. No clothes, no shoes. I just ran and got help. Because that was my father. As a child, and sometimes I decided I couldn't allow it to happen. My heart was telling me I couldn't allow that to happen.
And when he came back up, I just was just hanging. And you were a little 7-year-old boy holding me up.
Just feel the pain, the raw energy. And I've experienced that pain myself.
Some coffee camps that have
bless them with all your heart.
I've been sober for 5.5 years. And I'm a representative for the disabled vets. Some of our men, some of our comrades lost their legs, or lost their lives. I never had the opportunity to grieve, to show pain. And we pass that on to our children.
Through the Heal on Earth poll, they gave a chance to their Rose Town. And the line was for the Forgotten Warriors. And the Forgotten Warriors are the children of the veterans.
I placed my children today, and I placed many traumas on them. And the beating of the wife when I was drinking. The words I said to my kids in hurting. Taking my son through the suicide. I took him to Craig to carry the pole to center himself.
Thank you.
Friday before the pole raising, there was a lightning storm, which aren't unusual. It's not that we never have lightning storms, but they're not common. And the lightning struck where the pole was, waiting to be carried to its site, and then it also struck at the ball field, at the site of the sweat lodges. And telling people that, some of the elders, I think it was, they said that that's a blessing, that is a blessing and a cleansing to have lightning strike. Stan is a killer whale. You know, we see killer whales here yearly, but this was a very, this was not the time that we normally see killer whales. One of our guests had gone out on the boat early the day the pole raising, saw killer whales. Stan's initial reaction was, I had invited all my relatives and they've all come. A huge blessing and miracle of the whole pole raising was that the day of the pole raising, it was a sunny day. It had been storming for 2 weeks before the day of the pole raising, and it immediately started storming the day after the pole raising.
To see the whole community come together like that, I've never seen as many people in Craig in one place. As open to communication with each other ever. Everybody being able to pick up a 4,000 pound log and carrying it 9 blocks, they ought to be able to do a lot more stuff in the community together.
Relationship that I've had with my dad hasn't always been the best. A lot of it was resentment. I mean, I loved him, but there was a time in my life that I didn't care if he lived or died. You know, I didn't really care about him at all. When I got clean and sober, I looked back and I figured out where my resentment came from. And so I let go of a lot of it, but carving the totem pole, it really made me proud of my father, my dad. listed on there. Not only for my brother, but I lost a lot of friends. And I placed it on there. For them, too. I really feel that I went through all I went through so I can be a positive example. I work really well with kids because I've never ever forgotten how alienated I felt.
I'd set down two roses. One was for my daughter, one was for her mother. I'm walking the road with my father, neither behind him nor in front of him, I'm right beside him, walking that red road of recovery. As an Alaskan native, alcoholism and drug addiction, like my father stated earlier, it hasn't been with our ancestors. And when I do, dress to dance, today I am not using it. The dancing is to honor. It's to honor my grandmother. It's to show the respect that I do have today. And it's also for sobriety.
People were, we used to hold each other, put our blanket of love around you, help you through this grief time. The pool was holding them up and lifting them up and sharing them, strengthening them to walk through that grief. And still well today, every time you go by, you're going to think about one of your loved ones or someone that passed on.
The pool, too, was so beautiful. I feel like my brother would be so proud. It also is a way my dad could express his love, how he might not have shown his love as much as he could have. He could tell he carved it with his heart.
And when you listen to many Native Americans talk about the drumming, they say that the drumming is supposed to represent the beating of the heart. Yeah. And I'm wondering, for those of us where drums are important, the pahu is important. I'm a hula dancer. whenever I hear drum, the pahu, it resonates with me because of the pahu. Yeah? So I hear the drumming as something just as part of our soul. Anybody else have that reaction to drums? What else stood out for you? Yes?
What was the similarities as the inner people of the Eha and the Thets, and how you try to replace it with something else, so with substance abuse, domestic abuse, ocean away from each other as natives, we still are dealing with that.
As colonized indigenous people, the Eha seems to be very similar. Yeah, the Eha and the effects of the Eha are really similar across indigenous people. And how to heal from it. Yeah, how to heal from it. What else stood out for you?
I like how they said that part of it was from the forgotten warriors, because they also had to go through a trauma that they didn't understand.
That's right.
And I feel like it happens a lot today, and we just really don't know, because it's really the kids that hurt more, because the understanding isn't there. And it's something that they won't be able to experience. And that they were able to like take the totem pole and that uplifting that they were trying to do, and like their shared grief, and just overcome it.
So the roses, some of the roses were in honor of the wounded warriors, and the wounded warriors were the children of the veterans. Yeah? And the totem became a symbol of healing for the community, not just for Stan's family, but for the community, because Stan and the family understood that that Eha was a community Eha. Yeah. What else stood out for you? So what are some symbols of hope, which is what that totem is? What are some of the symbols of hope in our culture? Symbols of hope. Say that again?
Our language.
Okay. The emergence and renaissance of our language, and how we celebrate our language, especially on this campus, there are celebrations of Olelo and Mo'olelo, yeah, that we can participate in. What else are symbols of hope in our culture?
The Hokulea.
I was just thinking about that. The Hokulea is spending this year going around the islands, right? Before they embark on a worldwide tour next year. And remember, the Hokulea could have been a symbol of failure, right? When Edia Aikau died in that fateful trip, Nainoa Thompson said, "We were all devastated with grief, devastated with guilt. And we said, we're never going to do this again because we didn't have the energy and the spirit and the drive to do this. And our elders in the community said, if you don't move forward with this, the Kokulea was going to be put in a museum and it would be a symbol of failure. Symbol of failure, saying you Hawaiians couldn't get it done. But instead, the Hokulea is a symbol of hope, resurgence, of a practice that was dead in our culture, that is now alive. And so many of our young people have been inspired to look at navigating by the stars. So the Hokulea is a very important symbol of hope. What else are symbols of hope?
Well, it's interesting how what we're sharing, a lot of it is hope. culture. And so what comes to my mind is hula.
Absolutely.
How it's, you know, how it survived and actually really grown and expanded to other countries. But the other thing too is it's aloha. I mean, I used to be cheesy about it, but it's really the word aloha. And it's kind of interesting because, you know, I always hear people ask me, especially when I was working in the tourism industry, well, you know, what is aloha? People still don't understand what aloha is.
Because it can't be sold as a commodity.
Mm-hmm.
So the resurgence of hula is a symbol of hope. How many of you have been to Kaho'olawe? You know, it's the makahiki season now, right? And so there are makahiki events that are being established, developed, conducted all over the place. But as part of the makahiki now, there are those cultural protocols, right? Cultural protocols and going to Kaho'olawe and making that 7-mile trek as part of makahiki is also a cultural renewal. Working in the lo'i, all of these lo'i that are being established, particularly for educational purposes, that's a symbol of hope, cultural renewal. Yeah? Lots of different activities, lots of different practices that are being basically revitalized. Lots of symbols of hope. And I want to ask a question. For those of you who are sitting here, for how many of you are you the first in your family to go to college? The first in your family to go to college. You are a symbol of hope for your families. How was it that you or your family decided that you were going to go to college? Those of you who had your hands up, how was it decided that you were going to go to college? How was it decided that you were going to go to college?
It was kind of just option. I didn't have any other options.
So how did you decide you were going to go to college?
I felt that I wanted to
speak up so they can listen.
I wanted to learn more, so I guess.
Okay, but I'm assuming that you had it in you, that you decided, yeah, that you could do it, yeah? Something in your ohana or your community helped with that resilience and that self-confidence that said, I can go to college. Yeah? What about for you? How was it decided that you were going to go to college? First one in your family.
How I was brought up and I was just a little bit not always having enough money or making ends meet, and I think that's also what the money is one of the reasons why my parents fought and made tension. And so for me, I didn't want that for myself and for my family. My goal is when I get my career,
so something inside of you said, I want something different for myself.
But okay. My mom and my parents didn't force us. I mean, they forced us to go to school, but they didn't force us to do a bunch of other things and get super involved. It was more, you do it because you want to do it.
Okay. So they said, you've got some choices in your life system that you can make. Some hands up over here. How was it decided that you were going to go to college? Because you were the first in your family.
Well, for me, it was, I didn't really have a good time for it. And there's been and my world was like for drug users and stuff. And I just told myself that I didn't want that for my kids. So to be an example for my kids, I decided that. Well, actually, not to be an example as well, but then I cannot tell my kids what I want them to do if I never take that walk myself.
Okay.
that I had.
So there is something inside of you that said, I'm going to change my family mo'olelo.
And that's pretty much why I do what I do now, is because I don't like that for
right.
my kids.
At some point, though, there is some resiliency that spurred you on and motivated you to do something different, because you are going to change your family mo'olelo. What about you?
I overcame addiction, and I was raised in a... my parents brought me up well, and I took that and I ran with it, and I overcame addiction. I graduated, and I proved to myself that I can do this. I graduated from a substance abuse counseling, and I continued my education. It was important to me to break the cycle.
So you're going to change your family mo'olelo too. Somebody else have their hands up here? Yeah.
For me, being graduate of a private school, it was expensive.
Okay. Meeting expectations. But there is something inside of you that said, I can do this.
Yes.
So, Manu said, talk about how cultural, historical trauma and higher education are related. So after hearing me talk for an hour and a half, 2 hours, what does cultural historical trauma have to do with you sitting here at the University of Hawaii at Manoa?
It gives us the opportunity to move forward and actually help change our family's way of life. So we can still strengthen the Hawaiian culture by getting up there, being well educated, and being just as high up as, I wouldn't like to be prejudiced, but how you are.
Okay. So getting an education is really critical for making some professional decisions about what you want to do with your life. Thank you. Somebody else. What is cultural historical trauma? What did you learn about cultural historical trauma that you can relate to what it means to be in higher education now? You look like you want to say something. Yeah.
I have so much to say. For me, it's so beneficial to realize how it affects, you know, your education. I mean, you have to, because I'm around so many people who are the Hawaiians, but they're just so westernized now. And I just want to educate them about, you know, because we need to perpetuate our culture. And, you know, without the knowledge of the history of anyone, how can you do that? And my brother, he's like a prime example. I felt so insulted when he said that, but he's my older brother. So it's only a matter of educating, yeah, so that we can continue to perpetuate and then our kids are people who, you know, who are, they're gonna grow up and they're gonna live a culture that they do not. And that is, you know, so breaking the cycle.
So how many of you have the kuleana now? I mean, I've heard from many of you. By show of hands, how many of you have the kuleana of breaking a cycle, changing your family mo'olelo? Big kuleana, yep. Big kuleana. The fact that you're sitting here today is real inspiring to me. I love seeing our younger Hawaiians pursuing higher education. Because you have big kuleana now. Big kuleana. And of course, as a kupuna, I always say, and you're going to be giving back. It's 12. Any final last minute? Anything you want to say?